keep your car running and all that. I can see some are getting warm. I know it's getting toasty out there, but y'all pray about that. I hope this don't last too much longer, but we do need to come together, even if we just have to see each other. And it shouldn't be just at Walmart. Amen. It should be at church. It's a type of sacrifice. We do understand those that are not able to come in the bathroom situation. We're hoping that if we can continue this, we can resolve some type of issue with the bathroom so that people can do that. I know my preacher friend, Brother Rodney, they let one person go in at a time and things, and we're just trying to be real safe since this is the first time we're doing this. But without any further ado, I'll hush up. Let's start the service with prayer again, this 11 o'clock service. Let's ask God's blessing. Father, in Jesus' name, we want to glorify you, magnify you. You are worthy of our praise, God. You are worthy of all the accolades there are. Thank you, God, for living for us. Thank you for dying for us. Thank you for making salvation free to whosoever will. Lord, the red, yellow, black, or white, Lord, thank you for dying for the one that's in deep sin to the one that doesn't think they're that bad. I know that we're all sinners and we come short of your glory. Help us today, Lord, to magnify you, worship you in spirit and truth. Help us, Lord, to cast off the unfruitful works of darkness and cleave to that which is good. Help us, Lord, to cleanse our mind from any wayward thought, and help us just to allow your spirit to work in our lives. Thank you for our church. Thank you for all our guests and friends listening and watching. God, do that work in our hearts today, we ask in Jesus' name. And all God's people, flash your headlights maybe. Amen.
Passed through the ages, God's law demanded again and again. Without shedding blood, no remission of sin. There must come a lamb, atonement be made. It is finished at Calvary, the last debt was paid. I'm saved, forgiven. I've been born again, washed in the blood of the crucified Lamb, set free from sin's chains. My life's been changed. I stand no longer condemned. You may wonder why tears fill my eyes when I sing redemption's song, but I'll never get over what God put under the blood of an old rugged cross. I remember the time of conviction, strong power. A preacher was preaching, this is the hour, bearing the burden, the weight of my sin. Change me again and again. He said, behold the Lamb, the sacrifice made. It is under the blood, the debt has been paid. I'm saved, forgiven. I've been born again, washed in the blood of the crucified Lamb, set free from sin's chains. My life's been changed. I stand no longer condemned. You may wonder why tears fill my eyes when I sing redemption's song, but I'll never get over what God put under the blood of about. I don't remember them anymore. children, come and be blessed. All ye now heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Just lean on this promise, brother, you'll find it's true. I like the one that says I'm coming for you. I like the promise that he gave when he left. Oh, he's a rock and I can hide in the cleft. Oh, he will pilot my soul safely on through. I like the promise, I am coming for you. Pilgrims gone on before, loved ones who've left us now wait on that shore. Sometimes their leavings left me lonely and blue, till Jesus whispers, I'm coming for you. I like the promise that he gave when he left. Oh, he's the rock and I can hide in the cleft. Oh, he will pilot my soul safely on.
Continue on here. If we can figure out what we're going to do, let's do this one. He will carry you. I like this one.
Have you ever found yourself asking God where he's been? Ever get up out of bed saying I can't do this again? Have you ever been afraid of what tomorrow's gonna bring? And you're facing it alone, at least that's what you think.
I can tell you after going through that valley, even though I didn't see it at the time, it was in my weakest moments that he held me, and I know you'll find
he will carry you when you can't go on. He will be your strength when your strength is gone. He will lift you up, he will be enough to get you through. Wanna quit, 'cause you think you've got nothing left to give. You can fall apart, fall into his arms. He will carry you.
When you get the kind of news you hope you'd never hear, when you're chasing down a dream just to watch it disappear, when somebody that you love turns and walks away, and they leave you standing there with shattered faith.
You don't have to pick up all the broken pieces. You don't have to try to cover up the scars. You were loved and you can always run to Jesus, just as you are.
He will carry you when you can't go on. He will be your strength when your strength is gone. He will lift you up. He will be enough to get you through when the road is long and you want to quit because you think you've got nothing left to give. You can fall apart, fall into His arms.
His heart is never weary. No, He's never tired. Through the toughest times, through the longest nights, through the flood and through the fire, He will carry you when you can't go on. He'll be your strength when your strength is gone.
He will lift you up. He will be enough to get you through when the road is long and you want to quit because you think you've got nothing left to give. You can fall apart, fall into His arms. He will carry you. He will carry you.
The tomb began to shake, and like lightning from heaven, that old stone was rolled away. And as dead men, the guards, they just stood there in fright as the power from heaven displayed His light. Then suddenly a melody filled the riding wings of love, it was everywhere. The word all creation had been longing to hear.
Amen. Right before I preach here, I asked Gary, I put him on the spot. I said, can you sing that song about Simon and his two sons? Watch the Lamb. It was put out years ago by some famous songwriter, but I think it's a wonderful song. It's a story song. Gary does these wonderfully, and I'm thankful for it, the message in there, because it's all Bible, and it'll help you today.
Y'all pray for me, because I hadn't done this since last Easter. Amen. Maybe I won't do it again until next Easter. This is a story. It's in Mark 15:21. It's about Simon the Cyrenian. And Simon the Cyrenian, he came to Jerusalem. And he came to Jerusalem that day. The only thing he came for, he was just doing his Jewish duty. He was doing his Jewish duty. He was coming to sacrifice his lamb. He brought his two sons. His two sons, the name were Alexander and Rufus. And this is the story, walking on the road to Jerusalem. The time had come to sacrifice again.
Is that the right one, Pastor?
My two small sons, they walk beside me on the road. The reason that they came was to watch the Lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what will we see there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. There'll be so many in Jerusalem today. We must be sure the Lamb doesn't run away. Then I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. When we reached the city, I knew that something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then I heard the crowd cry out, crucify him. We tried to leave the city, but I could not get away. Forced to play in this drama, a part I did not wish to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? Why are we standing here when soon they would pass by? I looked and said, even now they come. The first one cried for mercy. The people gave him none. The second one was violent. He was arrogant and loud. I can still hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. And someone said, "There's Jesus." And I scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross and falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled. I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back. The crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, "You carry his cross." At first I tried to resist him. Then his hand reached for his sword. So I knelt and took the cross from our Lord. I placed it on my shoulder and started down the street. The blood that he shed was now running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his hands and his feet. And yet upon the cross I heard him pray, "Father, forgive them." Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. "And to thy hands I commit my spirit." He prayed, and then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. I'd lost all sense of time until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children, they stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, "Father, please, please forgive us, for the lamb ran away." "Daddy, Daddy, what will we see here? There's so much we don't understand. So I took them in my arms and I turned and faced the cross. Then I said, "Dear children, behold the Lamb."
Thank you. It's one of the most powerful songs, I believe. Get you thinking about eternal things. We need to think about eternal things. We really do. If this quarantine hasn't affected you, well, then I'll take your effect, because it has affected me. It's not as easy getting through things like this as it may seem. You said, "Well, we just gotta make do." And some people, some of your lives aren't changed much. You're still you still have to do the same routines, but for a pastor, it's been difficult not being able to plan like I have and looking forward to future things and wondering also what the future is going to behold. Now, on the flip side of it, I can get encouraged because I know it's not going to be long before we're home with Christ, amen? And that we don't have to worry that it's not going to be very long. And I hope that everybody knows Christ as their Savior. They'll understand that Jesus doesn't want to hurt you. He's not trying to offend you. He's not trying to make your life hard. He's trying to help you. Know that life isn't about this 70, 80, 90 years we may live on this side, but it's about eternity. It's about eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And I just want to share this with those that are listening on Facebook and the radio, but I grew up in a Presbyterian home. We didn't go to church all the time. My mom's here, and she can testify to that. Did the best they could, but I became religious at 16 years old. I did what you're supposed to do when they pressure you and they tell you you need to do these things. So I joined the church, and I thought joining the church would make the difference. I just did what was right, but that didn't change my heart. It changed some thoughts in my mind and things. And when I came, that was at 12 years old. When I became 16 and began to work more, work became more important to me, money and doing what I wanted to do. And Christ was an afterthought. It wasn't something that I was thinking about doing and participating in like I'm supposed to. And then I went to college and I graduated in 92 from Culinary College at Johnson Wells University. And in 1993, I realized there was more to life than what I had. I had a good job. I had scored high in my class. I had all the little things that I needed. I had money. I had a girlfriend at the time. I had everything that I needed except Jesus Christ. And I remember standing behind my couch in my two-bedroom apartment that I didn't need, saying there had to be more to life than this. And I found out there was, that the Lord had the Lord had pre-planned and had orchestrated, if you will, that a gospel track would be placed on my door, and I got that gospel track, and I read that gospel track, and it told me about Christ, it told me about church, and I remember calling my sister, and I said, should I go? She said, go. I went to church and didn't get saved that Sunday. It was a couple months later, but the pastor had called, and leadership had called, and I finally came to church December 5th of 1993, and I trusted Christ. I remember when he gave the invitation, and I raised my hand, and I accepted Christ as my Savior. A whole lot different than that day when I was 12 years old and I joined the church. A whole lot different. You know why it was different? Because my life changed completely. Oh, my motivation and focus was to do what I wanted to do. My motivation and focus was to be a culinary star and to work on the cruise liners and just be famous and all that. But that wasn't going to do anymore. Now Christ became my Savior, my Lord. He didn't deprive me of life. He didn't take anything away, but all the headaches and heartaches and the thoughts of hell and the actuality of hell, because Christ came and died and rose again. And we celebrate that resurrection event this morning. We celebrate it. That's why I can stand before you today when God called me to preach in 1995, that I declared that I'm no longer going to do what I want to do, but I'm going to surrender my life to a full-time ministry and say, Lord, whatever you'd have me to do, I'd be willing to do. Wherever you're going to take me, I'll go. Whatever is going to come my way. And all those years ago, God's still dealing with me, and he's still working on me. I haven't arrived. I haven't been perfected yet, but he's making sure that I straighten up when I don't do right. Amen. And some of y'all understand what I'm talking about. And I hope you know Christ as your personal Savior. Those listening, those that are here today, those that are in our neighborhood, maybe catching it on their front porch, I hope you have a full assurance of your salvation. This day is a day that we celebrate in the Christian realm is special because it's the day that fulfills salvation. I want you to think about this. And most of the time people say, well, if you just believe that Jesus is Lord, you're okay. Well, that's what the devil will tell you. The devil don't mind telling you believe that Jesus is Lord. The devil knows he's Lord. He understands he's Lord. And he don't mind you believing that. But the Bible says if you have to confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God hath raised him from the dead. Why is that important? Why is that in Romans 10:9? Why is that important to know and to believe? It's because it's one thing just to believe that Jesus is Lord. You can still live wicked as hell and believe he's Lord, and you have your own God, and that's yourself or the devil or whatever else. But then you go, I believe further than that, that not only is my Lord, but I believe that he rose from the grave the third day. What does that mean? He rose for my justification. I know in whom I believe, and I am persuaded that he's able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. What that means is that Jesus is no longer in the grave. What that means is that Jesus was not just man, but he was 100% man, touched in all temptations like as we are, yet without sin. He was 100% man, but he's also 100% God. And as 100% God, he had victory over death, hell, the grave. So that we can be here today in some sort of freedom to worship, some sort of freedom to proclaim, freedom of speech, freedom to gather, freedom of display, and to tell everybody that we know Jesus and we love Jesus. We are looking for Jesus to come today. Were you looking for him this morning? On the anniversary of the resurrection of Christ, the day that salvation for whosoever will has been fulfilled, this day some 2,000 years ago was fulfilled, that resurrection morning, boy, when the stone was rolled back and Christ up from a grave, he arose. There were people that day that went looking for him early that morning, but he wasn't there. Listen, he wasn't there. Some are still looking for him and they cannot see him. Some of you listening, watching, you're still, I'm looking for Jesus. I don't see him anywhere. Hey, I go to church, I don't see Jesus. I see people that say they know Jesus. I don't see Jesus in them. I don't see Jesus anywhere. I don't see him in, they're all hypocrites, they're all wicked, they're all full of hell. They're just sinners just like I am. We have come this morning, as well as multitudes all over the world, praying that we can see Jesus. If you can't find them, we're going to talk about that this morning. But in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. And in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 24, the Bible says, now think about this, Moses and all the Old Testament saints, most of them walk by faith, but in Hebrews 11, the faith chapter, it says this about Moses. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer the affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith, listen to this, he forsook Egypt. By faith. See, we've got to do things by faith as Christians. We want everything laid out. We want to see Jesus just like I want to see Jesus. We want Jesus to come and reveal himself when I tell him to, when I command him to. It don't work that way. Moses, by faith, forsook Egypt. Egypt was a type of the world. And Moses said, I don't want the world. I can claim it. I'm the prince of Egypt. I was raised by Pharaoh's daughter. Hey, I can claim it. But he denied it. He disclaimed it and said, I don't want it anymore. Not fearing the wrath of the king, but for he endured. And listen to this, seeing him who is invisible. Can we see God today? Yes, we can. He is often in our presence and we don't even realize it. We don't realize he's in our presence because of unbelief, because of preconceived thoughts, because of our own agenda. Some are still going, man, I've got to do something here in 10, 15 minutes. And you miss out on who Jesus is. You rather play your game, watch your television show, go fishing, go shopping, go do what you've got to do, and you'll miss Jesus. You'll miss him. You'll miss seeing him who is invisible. in the book of Mark chapter 16 is where I'm taking my message this morning from. In verse number 9 it says, "Now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils. And she went and told them that they had that had been with him, as they mourned and wept." In verse 11, "And they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. After that he appeared in another form." Listen to that. "He appeared in another form unto two of them, as they walked and went into the country." So he walked with them. "And they went and told it unto the residue. Neither believed they them. Afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat, and upbraided them that their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. And he said unto them, Go in all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe: in my name they shall cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." Verse 19, "So then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven, and sat on the right hand of God, and they went forth and preached everywhere, and the Lord working with them, and confirming the word with signs following." Amen. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we realize that doing outside services, there'll be many distractions. And Lord, I know the devil doesn't want us to see you clearly today. He doesn't want anybody listening to see. He wants us to be distracted or go on our own thoughts of what should happen or shouldn't happen. And Lord, I may some have some legitimate issues they need to take care of. But God, I pray that our hearts would be softened by the truth of your word. Lord, I'm just a spokesman. I'm just an ambassador of you. And I know I don't do the best job that needs to be done, but use my feeble efforts today. God, may I decrease and you increase. And may the hardness of our hearts become softened by the word. And may we see him who's invisible. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to ask this question. Can we see Jesus? At first, he appeared as a gardener. I want you to think about this. At first, Jesus appeared to Mary, and Mary thought he was a gardener. He looked like a gardener. He didn't understand. When he appeared to the others, he appeared to be someone else. They didn't recognize him. I wonder why that is. I wonder why he was not recognized. Was Christ purposely changing his identity? Was he purposely trying to deceive us or deceive them? Is he purposely trying to elude our thought processes, our mind? Is he trying to withhold faith from those that really desire? No, not absolutely not. Jesus Christ wants everyone to see him who is invisible. The reason why we cannot see him who's invisible is because of this: our hard hearts. Our hard hearts have already quenched the saving faith, the sustaining faith, the loving faith that God wants to give us. And what happened because of the hardness of their hearts and because of our quenching of the faith, our vision is clouded. We can't see him as invisible because we already have some preconceived notions. We already think that he's not there, and there's no reason to look. We don't need to look by faith, walk by faith, talk by faith. We just need to do what's practical and what seems logical to us. Allow faith to guide your heart and your head, and I believe you'll see him who's invisible. We have to get away from what the media and what the knotheads in Washington and what all the school teachers in the secular world are trying to teach our children, and then ultimately teach us, and what the television programming is trying to program us and indoctrinate us, that we don't need to trust Christ and we don't have faith, we have science. Can I tell you that faith proves science, and that science doesn't disprove faith? That those in this time period that I'm reading about, they at first could not see Jesus, but eventually they did. Because they engaged, they ignited, they activated that measure of faith I preached on the last service, and they were able to see him who's invisible. They couldn't believe nor see Jesus that day, I believe, for a momentary time, because they trusted their own opinion. Think about this just for a moment, church, all those that listening, watching, is that when we trust our own opinion, there's a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the ways thereof lead unto death. When we trust what we think is right, when we take the voice and the commands of the world, our own thoughts above the commands and the thoughts of God, then we are never going to see Him, and we're never going to walk by faith, and we're never going to really enjoy the resurrection morning, nor see the reason why we ought to come together every week multiple times, even so much more as we see the day approaching. If we trust our own opinion, if we allow this old flesh to dictate to us what we want to do, I guarantee you most of us, if not all of us, would be still laying in bed and still watching TV or eating popcorn or doing something we want to do out in the yard. We take this pretty day and we don't give glory to God. We give glory to ourselves and say, it makes more sense to do what I want to do. I'll go to church when it finally opens up. Look at verse 10. And she went and told them, had been with him, and as they mourned and wept. And you would think that the others that had been with him, they would have been more, they were weeping and they were crying. They were seemingly a part of it. They, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. They didn't want to see him either. Isn't it amazing? Sometimes we don't go to church. We don't engage. Maybe you're here. You don't engage in church because you're afraid if Christ gets up in your crawl, gets up in your car, gets up in next to you and starts pointing fingers at you and telling you your sin and exposing the wickedness in your life, your own opinions you're trusting rather than His truths, don't you just say, hey, just stay at a distance, whore. That's why we don't need to pray at home. That's why we don't need, I don't want Christ in my house. I don't want Christ, but just so far in my life. Pilate didn't mind Christ. He found no fault in him because he trusted his own opinion. Pilate washed his hands thinking that that was going to alleviate the justice that's going to have to come to his life. Unfortunately, trusting your own opinion will always blind you to where Christ is at. I want you to continue to read. And they went and told, verse 13, it unto the residue, and neither did they believe. Afterward, he appeared unto 11 as they sat at meat, unbraided them for their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which have seen after he was risen. Think about this. Christ, he had gathered around. He was exposing himself to everybody. He was showing himself. He was letting people know, look at me, I'm the risen Savior. But they believed not, nor they did not recognize him. It said they came. He came to in another form. That didn't, Christ didn't change his form. He didn't change his vesture. He came to them as if he was someone different, because they couldn't believe. Their own opinion dictated to them that he couldn't have risen, because Jesus was just a good man. He was there. He was real. Yet they were blinded to who he was. Maybe because they just couldn't believe that he could rise from the dead. Have you ever thought of that? That a lot of people, they don't want to believe in Christ. They say that's a bunch of hokiness to think that God came to this earth, to think that he rose the third day. How do you know that? Well, I can tell you this, just based on common sense, it would tell you this, is that 2,000 years ago, they saw it, they wrote about it, and we're still preaching about it today. Can I get an amen there? We realize that there's churches all over the world that are being started, and the people are getting saved, and their lives are being changed, and they have a peace that passes all understanding, and they realize that God is very God, and He came to this earth, and He died for their sins. How do I know it's real? Because He lives in me today. You can't trust your own opinion. Your own opinion will blind you to who Christ is. Maybe they couldn't believe because of the testimony of the former possessed. You thought about that? Mary come to him. Mary was the woman possessed with seven devils that Jesus cast out. And maybe they were thinking, Mary must be full of the devil again. Mary must have been. Have you ever met some of your former acquaintance church? You go back to them after you get saved. They know you partied. They know you drank. They know you drugged. They know you were whore hopping, and they know you all doing all wicked things. But God gloriously saved you, forgave you, and you go back to them. You say, hey, can I introduce you? Hey, here, this is my Jesus. And they're saying, I can't see him, because all they see in their life is that former drunk or that former sinner. Maybe the disciples and the rest of the gang around there was just seeing Mary for that old demon-possessed woman. See, they were trusting their own opinion. She can't be right. She just must have been drinking a little bit. She must be off her rocker. Many folks have got it all figured out in their own life. They pick and choose what to believe, and they create their own opinion. I know people that they won't read the Bible to build their opinion. They'll watch all the knotheads on YouTube and all the different religious leaders of the world that believe different things, and they don't believe the Bible. They add books to it, like the Mormon Church and the Jehovah's Witnesses. They mean well, but friend, they've got new books that's added to the Word of God. It's not right, and they trust their own opinion because it creates power within their own lives. You know what we're supposed to do? We're celebrating the power of the resurrection. The power of Christ over us, not our power over Christ. We submit unto the power of God. In Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 5, most of you understand this one and know it. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. Our opinions tend to be rooted in logic, which often is wrong. Our opinions tend to be rooted in practicality. It's not practical for me. I can't stay the whole time. I can't do this. I can't be a good Christian, so I'd rather go to hell. It's not practical. Or sometimes it's rooted in what we define as right and wrong. So you know, our society, the younger generation, is trying to, and you know the politics behind it too, pushing a new agenda, and what they're doing is they're trying to redefine what is right and what is wrong. They're going to do this at some point. They're going to say religion is wrong unless you do it our way. They're going to say have a relationship with Christ. No. You just need to have a relationship in God and whatever your God is. See, they're going to form their own opinion. And I've talked to many people over the years, and that's just where they're doing. And there is even people in the church, good-meaning people, but you can't see Jesus because you have justified some sin in your life. You have justified some area of unbelief in your life. And you say, well, God, it don't matter. God loves me anyway, so I'm going to stay in it. That's why when you come to church and God the Holy Ghost moves through the midst and people are shouting and praising God and getting saved and getting their heart right, you sit there like a bump the log, and you don't know Jesus is in the midst, and you don't care whether or not God is helping, you just want to get out. You say, I'm all right. I'm okay. My opinion is okay. Isaiah 26:4 says, trust in the Lord forever, for in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. Think about this. This is something I found. It says, man calls sin an accident, but God calls an abomination. Man calls sin a blunder, but God calls it blindness. Man calls sin a chance, but God calls it a choice. Man calls sin a defect, but God calls it a disease. Man calls sin an error, but God calls it wicked. Man calls it sin fascinating, but God calls it fatal. Man calls sin infirmity, but God calls it iniquity. Man calls sin luxury, but God calls it lawlessness. Man calls sin a mistake, but God calls it madness. Man calls sin a trifle, but God calls it a tragedy. Man calls sin weakness, but God calls it wickedness. You see, when we trust our own opinion in life, we tend to never see him who is invisible. Have you ever asked somebody to pray about something with you? Say, would you pray about it? And they'll immediately say, I'll go this way or that way. Have you ever talked to somebody, hey, would you pray with me about this particular situation for somebody? And they automatically just jump out and they say, no, I think they're, let's say you pray for brother so-and-so, he needs to be saved. Whatever. You know what, those type of people are people that trust their own opinion. So they'll say, well, I've been praying for him for years or her for years, and I'm going to tell you it might take years. It took 21 years for God to get a hold of my heart. Thank God I had mamas and daddies and sisters and people praying for this old soul. They weren't giving up on me. Keep on praying. There's people that trust their own opinion, and they'll never see Jesus. But thank God, as soon as we want to trust Christ, we can see him who's invisible. Our eyes will be open. Our lives will be changed. We walk with a new walk. We have a peace deep down in our heart. We know in whom we believe, and we are persuaded. Hallelujah. How can we see Christ today? Well, we got to stop trusting our opinion and start trusting faith. They couldn't believe they couldn't see him that day because of wrong placed emotions. I love emotion. You see me get emotional. Boy, a little breeze run through and God just gets all over me. Gary's singing that song. And I just put myself on that road with, oh, whoo, glory. Hey, emotions, not wrong with emotions unless they're wrongly placed. Unless you let your emotion of fear overcome you and dictate to you what you can and can't do for Christ. And I'm not just talking about the coronavirus. I'm talking about open your mouth for Jesus. I'm talking about your fear of giving your finances, your fear of giving your testimony, your fear of singing for Jesus, your fear of doing anything for Christ. Wrong placed emotions will blind you. Wrong placed emotions will blind you. I want you to turn, if you have your Bibles, the book of Luke, and it's the same story, just a little more detail. Luke 24, if you're not there, just listen. Verse 36, it says, "And as they thus spoke, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said, saith unto them, peace be unto you." By the way, why would he say that to start off with? Because they didn't have no peace. Because they were all the pieces. Christ had been crucified, been laid in the dead, grave for 3 days. But they were what? Terrified and affrighted and supposed that they had seen a spirit. Now, I just want for a second, it's not in my notes, I want you just for a second. These men had seen the blind heal, the deaf hear, the lame walk, the dead rise, the multitudes fed. They'd seen miracle after miracle, but right now they couldn't see Jesus standing right in front of them. They were terrified. They were frightened. Why? Because they had wrong placed emotions and they didn't put them in the right place. Hey, Christ didn't leave them forever. He said, "He'll never leave thee nor forsake thee." Christ went away to fulfill the plan of salvation. And he came, he justified us, and he's going to justify us again. Amen. I thank God for sanctification, and I thank God for justification. Wrong place emotions blind them. Jesus, and he said unto them, "Why are you troubled? And why are your thoughts arise in your hearts? Behold, my hands and my feet, that it is myself. Handle me." There wasn't no coronavirus then. Amen. "For a spirit hath not flesh and bones, as ye see me have." When your emotions are in the wrong place, when they're used wrongly, they will only let you see trouble. They will only let you see scary things. Now those men there, they had seen some what we would call pretty scary, wouldn't you think? But I don't know, you see a dead person and go, "Oh, whoop, there you go. Well, hey, that's pretty scary." See the little girl, woman with issue of blood? Pretty scary. But when your emotions are placed in the right place, you're not affrighted, you're not terrified, you're full of peace. And you say, "That's my King. That's my Savior. That's my Lord." Seeing the risen Savior takes place when you put your emotions in the right place, putting them through faith. Wrongly placed emotions, what does it do? It robs us of our peace. It blinds your eyes where they cannot see him who's invisible. They had walked and lived with Christ for 3.5 years. Now they couldn't even see him standing right in the midst of them. You remember when you could see Jesus in your prayer times? You close your eyes and you could sense the presence of God. Remember when you could see Jesus in the sermons, when you could come to church and you sit there and you could, as the preacher preached, see the Christ being defined and him just ministering to you. You remember when you could see Jesus when you opened your King James Bible and you flipped through the pages and you read the wonderful words of life and how Christ became alive to you and there'd be truths that come out for you. Do you remember when you could listen to gospel music and that music would minister to your heart and say, "Peace, be still"? Do you remember when you could see Jesus in the blooms of the beautiful flowers? Remember when you could see Jesus when you look in the trees and you see them all pointing up to heaven? Do you remember when you could see Jesus before you've allowed wrongly placed emotions? And see, let me tell you, no emotion is an emotion. No emotion is an emotion. You ever felt like you're dead? Just felt like you're just numb? You remember Malchus? Peter cut off his ear. You know, he got touched by God. His ear was lopped off. His ear's on the ground, and Jesus knelt down and he picked it up and he put it on, put it back on Malchus's ear, and he was numb to it because his emotions were placed wrong. The disciples were frightened. They thought they saw a spirit. The virus has blinded many from seeing the risen Savior. If your sight is still blurry, I want to encourage you to listen for a still small voice. For my sheep hear my voice, and they follow me. But the virus isn't the main thing. This is just a kind of a booster that the old devil's using to put fear in people to where they wonder what's going to happen. If we all keep doing what we're supposed to be doing for the Lord Jesus, the rapture is going to take what's happened. Amen. The rapture is what's going to happen. If we keep on doing what we're supposed to be doing for Christ, the saved were shaken at this time. Their faith was shaken. But Jesus keeps on talking. I thank the Lord that he doesn't give up on us like I do. I give up on myself sometimes. I get so discouraged and distraught that I just say, why do I keep on dealing with this, these thoughts and these fears? The Bible says neither give place to the devil. Old saying is you give the devil an inch, he'll become a ruler. But you find this, that after Jesus kept talking, and that's why I'm glad and I'm encouraged that you're here, and those watching and listening, that you're still listening. You see, one thing that we can say is that they couldn't see Jesus for a while, right? But Jesus stuck with them. Jesus stuck with them. And he kept talking. And in Luke 24:39, they began to see Jesus when fellowship was accepted. Let me put it in a simple way before I read it. If I call you on the phone and I say, hey, I want you to come over and fellowship with me. I want you to, we're gonna cook some fish and have some honey. I don't know if I've ever put honey on fish, but that sounds like a good biblical idea, amen? We'll find out in a second. But you never show up. I'll never see you if you never show up, right? If you don't want a fellowship, I'm not going to see you. Here we find Jesus. He shows up, and they want to fellowship. You see, in times like that we're in, it's so easy to lose sight of Christ. We all fail. Our eyes get blurry at times. We take our eyes off the prize, the Lord Jesus, but God's still with us. He's still guiding us. He still loves us. He's not going to leave us. He's going to stick with us. Can I say amen to that? No matter what the world may throw at us, Christ is always there for us. But they had to do something. If you want to see Christ today, you've got to be willing to fellowship with him. You've got to be willing to reach out to him and say, God, I need you. God, I want to walk with you. I want to talk with you. I want to love on you today. Here they wanted to eat with him. It says in verse 39, behold my hands and my feet, that it is myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones as you see me have. In verse 40, and when he had thus spoken, he showed him his hands and his feet, and while they believed not for joy and wondered, he said unto them, have ye any meat? And here it is. See, Christ promoted it. You remember that day that Christ spoke to your heart to be saved? We love him because he first loved us. Jesus loved them because they don't love Jesus first. Jesus loves them. He says, do you have any meat? He knew they had meat. Jesus was prompting them as he's doing today. He's asking the church today, you have any meat? You want a fellowship? You want to spend some time with me? Verse 42. And they gave him a piece of broiled fish. For all you healthy people, amen. It wasn't fried and fat bag. In of a honeycomb. And they took it, and he took it, and he did eat before them, and he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things, it says, that all things must be fulfilled which are written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Verse 45. Then open he their understanding, that he might understand the scriptures. that they might understand the scripture. Now, real quick, why doesn't it say you open up their eyes? Their eyes were already open. They could see Jesus clearly. But because of their own opinion trusting, because of misplaced emotions, their understanding of who he was wasn't there. So Christ and his love for fellowship and his giving of an opportunity for them to fellowship with him, he opens up their understanding and they go, oh. And he said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. I believe the Lord is still speaking to us today, trying to open our eyes and understanding. He's trying to heal the brokenhearted. I believe Christ wants fellowship. That's why he created us. He wants fellowship. It is hard to fellowship with something you can't see. You know why we probably, just like all churches, are probably going to probably miss out on some people. Some people are going to fall through the cracks because we haven't been able to fellowship with them. People don't fellowship. Don't you agree with that? When you're not around somebody enough, you just lose track of them. You just lose thought of them. And Christ had been gone 3 days and they had lost track. Their own opinion had overtaken, emotions had overtaken. But Christ said, if you just receive, accept my fellowship. Fellowship means this. And I'm almost done. Fellowship means letting others into your life. Letting others into your life. He offered them to touch him. He said, touch my hands. See, touch my feet. He offered them to come. Come be a part of my life. For us today, Jesus is saying, come, take my word in your hands. Open it up. Feel and see the truths that lie within the scriptures here. Come and touch me, whom is invisible to you. And I will open your understanding. I will let you see me in the scriptures. I'll let you understand that the Bible just isn't leather bound bunches of pages, but it is the very word of God in paper form for you and I. We can handle and fellowship with the Lord Jesus even today. They offered him up food, honeycomb. It's probably because it's two healthiest things on earth, fish, amen, Mom, and honeycomb. And you know what Christ did? He didn't say, no thanks, I'm a meatitarian. No thanks, I'm a vegetarian. Not knocking any of you that are. I'm just trying to be funny. But he ate it. Let me explain why this is important. Have you ever had anybody come to your house? It's usually the kids of somebody. You have friends over and their kids are coming, or maybe a finicky person. And you sit down, you prepare a meal, and they sit there and they go, and you go, you're not going to eat? Oh, I don't like any of that. Oh, I can't eat that. Ooh. What do you mean? We have chicken, beef, fish. We have it fried, broiled. We have it every way. And here I think it's the most simplest way you can provide food. And here Christ didn't shun it. Christ accepted it. He ate it. And that's why Scripture says to eat whatsoever set before you. Amen? Now that means other people, not you keep setting stuff before you. So everybody that's struggling with weight, that's not an excuse there. But let me finish here. The table. There, they were sitting around and they were sitting and they were fellowshipping with Christ. My last point is they accepted the fellowship. When you sit around the food, what do? You fellowship. You fellowship. Some people say, well, I'm not hungry. No, what you're saying is you're not hungry for fellowship, because you can still fellowship without eating, but eating always helps. You stay around a little while. Amen. They could see him. Because their understanding was open. Let me finish with this last sentence illustration. In many years of pastoring, I have made some presumptuous thoughts about people I meet. You meet people and on the surface you make a judgment, and you do it too. Don't throw a stone. You do the same thing. You make, you know, kind of first, what's it called? First impressions. Many people, I've made first impressions, and some have been good, some have been bad. And either way, this has happened on both sides, where maybe I thought there's something wrong with that person, And then I got to fellowshipping with them. You sit down and you talk with them. You find out where they've come from. You find out all the licks in life that they've taken. You find out all the troubles and trials. And then you realize, I really didn't know you. I couldn't really see you. I see you now for why you're dealing with this and why you maybe act this way. Just like the little children that come to our church, sometimes they misbehave and we don't understand. We don't see them as a child we think they ought to be. But you get to fellowship and you get to find out that they hadn't eaten anything in a couple of days, or their mom and daddy are drunk or drug addicts, or they've come from broken homes. They've been beaten and bruised or molested of, oh God, help. You begin to see them for who they are. You understand. You fellowship for a while. You understand now. Christ opened their understanding and they saw him. For a savior that was not forsaking them, did not forsake them, but they saw him as Lord. And you know how I know that it made an impact? Is in all these accounts that Jesus gave the Great Commission, go in all the world and preach. He's saying this: when you see me, when you want a fellowship with me and you discard all your misplaced emotions and you discard your own opinion and you stop trusting that and you start fellowshipping with me and let me open your understanding, then you're going to be prepared. That's when you're going to be prepared. That's when you're going to be, it's going to be easier to tell people that Jesus loved you. That's when it's going to be so simple to say that God loves you and I want to help you and I care about you and I may have had a false impression, but let's fellowship with you. For when we get to fellowship with people, you know what it'll do? It opens our eyes of understanding. They could see him because their understanding was open. They now understood and believed that Jesus did die and did rise the third day. They did realize that Mary was telling the truth. There's going to be a lot in heaven when we all get to heaven. We're going to say, man, they were telling the truth. Wow. They realized their opinion was wrong. They realized their emotions were guiding them rather than faith. Today, we have a choice to see Jesus. See him as risen Savior. See him as peace giver and as a friend, as a personal Savior. There's that song, I'm not going to sing it, but because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Church, we're here today because God lives. We may be gone tomorrow because he lives. I hope that today we will start trusting God's truth, not our pain. Start putting emotion in its right place and get excited for Christ and be fearful of the lost people going to hell, and so we can have compassion and pull them out and help them. I hope we'll want to fellowship with God and spend some time in prayer and intimacy with Christ. Would you do that? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for this resurrection morning. Thank you, Lord, that we can worship outside in this beautiful weather. Thank you for the breeze that's been all morning. The beautiful music we've heard that's ministered to our hearts. Lord, these dear people, their smiling faces, the horns that they honk, and Lord, just the encouragement we have. And God, I know that we could, if we lived in China, we couldn't even do this in China. So thank you for this little bit of liberty that we have today. And I pray that those that are listening in our neighborhood and on the internet would understand that we just want to just try to get them to see Jesus. Lord, help me reflect Jesus in my life. Let the light that you put in me be revealed to those around me. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you for coming. It's a good day. It's not too far after 12. It's still a beautiful day. We're going to go back to normal service tonight as far as broadcasting within inside. And maybe if this thing continues, we'll do some one calls and maybe some polling here of you guys, whether we want to start doing this on a regular basis if we have to still continue the social distancing. Thank you for your sacrifice for coming in restrooms. I know some of your eyeballs are floating right now, and God bless you for coming out for that. And would you do this favor for me? Would you call the people that you maybe didn't see and just make sure they're okay? I'll do my part, do the best I can, and just make sure they're okay. They may have stayed home because it's easier for them or for whatever reason, but please do that. So I guess, Lester, you play a little bit as dismissing music maybe? Or oh, by the way, before we leave today, we talked about in Matthew chapter 16 that God will give us power over deadly serpents. And this morning when we come to church, I was parking the van over there, and Leslie come out and said, there's a copperhead in the door here. And Leslie didn't take him up by her hands, but got a broomstick and put him in eternal hell. Amen. Put him in hell. But you chopped him up a little bit. But isn't that something that we're not a snake handling church today, but we'll handle them if we have to. Amen. Hey, God bless you. You have a wonderful resurrection day. Tell everybody that you love Jesus. God bless you. Be safe. We'll see you tonight.